Thank you for joining us today on this Resurrection Sunday as we celebrate the Savior we love and serve, conquered death, conquered hell, conquered the grave, on this day that we remember his resurrection. He had no sin and death could not hold him. He rose and gives all of us new life, new hope. If you're visiting with us today, we ask you to fill out a connection card so we can get to know you and you can get to know a little bit more about us. Connection cards are available in front of you in the seats. Also, you can find it online, machurch.net, and also the app. Just fill out a connection card and put an email address on there, and we'd be glad to put you in touch with our e-bulletin, let you know what's going on from week to week. Also, today we have some balloons for all of our children. We only have a limited number of them, but they'll be available at the exit to your right as you exit the sanctuary this morning after service. So let's pray together and we'll get started today. Father, we thank you for the symbolism of this day that we celebrate, this Resurrection Sunday. You conquered death, hell, and the grave, and you bring us new life. We commit to you this time. We pray that you'd move in our hearts by your Spirit, that we'd understand the significance of this day and the new life that we have in Jesus. Bless our congregation, bless our team as they lead us in worship, and bless our Pastor James as he shares your word. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may stand. We'll start worship. He has risen. Let's do it one more time. Come on, guys. He has risen. Awesome. Fantastic. We're going to read Luke 24, 1 through 6 together. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." Praise God. Praise God.
Ah, hallelujah. Spirit lost and searching, wanting something more. Find the risen King who overcomes the world. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Condemnation, no more doubt and fear. For our sin and shame, they have no power. In His resurrection, perfect love has set the captives free. Praise the risen King who stands in victory. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive.
Hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh, in Jesus. Oh, in Jesus, hallelujah.
Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh, in Jesus. Oh, in Jesus, hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. Overcome, oh, in Jesus, oh, in Jesus.
Let there be
dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive.
Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are running, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. No rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever guide your way. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever guide your way. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Holy, holy, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Amen. Worthy is the Lamb. Righteous is the Lamb. Jesus is the Lamb. Amen. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you are all things, and you deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy. To you are all things, you deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you are all things. You
Father, we thank you for your Son rising from the empty tomb. Help us to recognize what that means for us, not just today, but each and every day that we're here on this earth. Help us to remember what we were purchased from, which was death. We love you. We pray that for Pastor James, as he comes up here with your word, that we would see you in a new light and that we would be stretched to become more like your Son, Jesus. Amen.
You may be seated. Good to have you here this morning. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen.
What a wonderful day of celebration that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. We're wrapping up our series, Dinner with Jesus, and what a great day to do that. What a great day of celebration. I want to thank Rasan and the rest of the team this morning for putting on a wonderful breakfast. How many of you were able to enjoy that this morning? They did a fantastic job, and I think what a great way to celebrate our risen Savior than to gather together and eat. That's a great way to celebrate, isn't it? Especially when we're finishing up this series, Dinner with Jesus. Jesus used meals as part of his mission to share who he was with others. He encountered people around the table, regardless of their background or their status. Jesus gathered and ate with all sorts of people. He demonstrated love and compassion, the love and compassion of the Father, and he paved the way for people to see the kingdom, to come to know him. Jesus was intentional even around the dinner table, and it's something as simple as a shared meal provides an opportunity to go deep with others. We're in Luke chapter 24 this morning. A passage that I called Eyes Open, because that's literally what takes place in this passage. The eyes are opened of followers of Jesus to see who he is together. Friday was a day of remembrance. We had an experiential walkthrough of different events that took place on Good Friday here at the church. We had a garden area, the trial, the cross. We shared in communion. And it seemed like the cross and the tomb were the hopeless end of everything. But this morning we're here to celebrate that death was not the end. Jesus is alive. He is risen from the dead. We're going to read again Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. So it's going to be up on the screen. I want you to just go ahead and stand. I know we did this as part of our worship this morning. But let's go back to God's word and prepare our hearts to hear from him this morning. Let's read together. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you this morning, and we ask that you would speak to us through your word. We pray that you would quiet our hearts, that our hearts would know, our minds would know, our souls would know the reality of Jesus Christ being risen from the grave. That this would not just be something we know in our heads, but it would transform us, that it would move us to a place of greater intimacy with you because of what you've done for us. We pray that as we open your word this morning, Father, that your Spirit would come to rest upon us, that we would be entered into your presence in such a way that, Father, we cannot stay the same. that this truth, this reality, this good news of Jesus Christ would transform us from the inside out. We pray that you would be glorified by all that is said and done, Father. And we ask this in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is risen from the dead. We ask this in his name, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. As we just read Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12 this morning, we're left kind of perplexed with this response. See, we're reading this passage from beyond history here. We're reading it as it's already happened. We know what has taken place. This is not new to us. And so I want us to kind of immerse ourselves into this account this morning. I want us to respond to the text as if this is the first time that we've ever heard this news of Jesus being raised from the dead. Put yourself in the situation of the 11, in the situation of the women who had responded to the tomb, of those who had heard the news that Jesus had died, but all of a sudden the tomb is empty and his body is no longer there. And when you do that, you start to see there's this response of maybe unbelief, this response of doubt, this sense of nonsense. This doesn't make sense. What happened? Was Jesus really who he said he was? How does this impact us today? Friends, as we've been going through this series, Dinner with Jesus, it's time to come to the table one more time. It's time to meet with Jesus. In your Bibles, go ahead and open to Luke chapter 24. We're going to look at the rest of Luke 24 this morning. It'll also be on your screen. If you're joining with us online, it'll be on your screen as well. And we're going to hear this story, this account of two on the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. Look at what Luke says in verse 16. But they were kept from recognizing him. Verse 17. He asked them, Jesus asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days? Kind of like, where have you been? You should know. Verse 19, Jesus' response, what things? What things, he asked them. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied, he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him. These two are walking away from Jerusalem, Cleopas and his companion. They're walking away from Jerusalem toward a village called Emmaus, and it was about a 7-mile journey. The Passover had ended. They're returning home. It had been 3 days since these events had taken place, since Jesus had been crucified, died, and was buried. And do you catch the sense of hopelessness and the sense of disbelief that God had allowed this to take place? Cleopas and his friend were utterly amazed at the events that had transpired. And they're talking about everything that had taken place. And you get this sense of dashed hopes, of broken dreams and disappointments. It's all throughout this passage. As we look at this passage, it's full of dashed hopes, of broken dreams and disappointments. what they had longed for, what they had looked for, what they had anticipated, who they viewed Jesus to be. Everything had come crumbling down before them. And they wondered among themselves, what has taken place? When all of a sudden a stranger comes and joins them on the journey. Now we know that it's Jesus. The text says that it's Jesus. But Cleopas and his friend don't recognize the risen Savior for who he is. Scripture says that they were kept from recognizing him. Now Jesus is in his glorified body. He looked similar because others recognized him. And yet Jesus has a glorified resurrected body. And maybe when we have glorified and resurrected bodies, you may not recognize us either. I'm going to be about 6'2". You may not recognize me in my glorified body. But for whatever reason, Jesus is not recognized by Cleopas and his friend. And Jesus enters the conversation, and I think with a sense of knowing that they're shocked, they're in disbelief, their hopes have been dashed, their dreams have been broken, and there's this sense of disappointment. And Jesus just casually asks, what's going on? What are you talking about? And again, there's this sense of disbelief and shock. Like, where have you been? Have you not heard? All the city has been abuzz with these events. That this Jesus that we followed, he was betrayed. He was turned over to the religious leaders and he was crucified. He was beaten. He was crucified on the cross. He died a criminal's death. And it's been 3 days since this has happened. Jesus senses the disappointment in them. They talked with one another about everything that happened. Jesus' unjust trial, the disciples scattering, his beating, the crucifixion. And Jesus comes and walks with them and talks with them. And their response cannot hide how they're feeling, how they're responding. Notice the response, because even in the midst of this disappointment, there are glimmers of hope. So some of our women have left us amazed and perplexed because they went to the tomb and the tomb was empty. Jesus' body was not there. And they saw visions of angels who said he is risen from the dead. And even one of our own companions, we know that later on, this is Peter who is gone. Peter comes back and says he's not there. He must be risen. Cleopas and his friend hear the good news and yet it doesn't register. They're perplexed. Friends, life is full of dashed hopes, of broken dreams and disappointments. We all experience this from time to time. We all look for the answers to our own emptiness. And friends, it can be difficult for us to see God's faithfulness. It can be difficult for us to see his goodness and his presence at times. We easily lose hope. You see, we define hope as we hope so. We have this longing that something will happen. We wish for something to happen. And yet when Scripture defines hope, it is hope is sure. It is secure. It will come to pass. And these two had lost all hope. Have you ever lost hope? Have you ever lost hope? I think we all feel that, don't we? That there are times in this life when it's difficult, when we feel like God is absent, like there's nowhere for us to turn, like all hope has been lost and we don't know what to do and we don't know how to respond. The world around us is hopeless. It doesn't take long to see the brokenness of our world and to see the hopelessness in the eyes of those around us. The hopelessness that we experience here in the United States is the same hopelessness that others experience around the world. Cleopas and his friend have this sense of hopelessness that all had been lost. Do you feel like you have nowhere to turn? Their dream of a Messiah was broken, their disappointment overwhelming, and maybe that describes you this morning. Maybe you feel God is absent or he doesn't even exist. Maybe you feel that he is woefully ignorant of your situation. He is distant or distracted with other things. Maybe you feel that Jesus is completely irrelevant to your life. Your life is full of dashed hopes, of broken dreams. You've been left fully disappointed in God. It may seem like Jesus hasn't been present. I think this is where Cleopas and his friend are as they journey home. And yet something incredible takes place, because in the midst of the dashed hopes and the broken dreams and the disappointments, Jesus appears. And through the prophets and the scripture, we see Jesus is revealed. The prophets and scripture reveal Jesus. Let's continue on in verses 25 through 27. He said to them, Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Now, this is not an insult as much as it is a gentle rebuke. So Jesus isn't going to say, "You're a foolish idiot for not understanding." This is a gentle rebuke that he's offering to Cleopas and his friend. "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Haven't you seen the bigger picture? Scripture reveals who I am. It reveals the Father's plan. And Jesus starts with Moses and goes through all the prophets, all of Scripture, and explains who he is to them. What do you think they heard as Jesus spoke with them? I think this is a little glimpse of that conversation. As Jesus in Genesis said, in Genesis, "I am the creator and sustainer of all." In Exodus, "I am the Passover lamb." In Leviticus, "I am the high priest." In Numbers, "I am the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night." In Deuteronomy, "I am a prophet like Moses." In Joshua, "I am the captain of your salvation." In Judges, "I am the righteous judge and lawgiver." In Ruth, "I am your kinsman redeemer." In 1 and 2 Samuel, Jesus would have said, "I am the anointed shepherd king." In 1 and 2 Kings, "I am the righteous king of kings." In Judges, in 1 and 2 Chronicles, "I am the faithful restorer of the kingdom." In Ezra, "I am the faithful scribe." In Nehemiah, "I am the rebuilder of the broken walls of life." In Esther, "I am the sovereign protector of my people." In Job, "I am the dayspring on high." In Psalms, "I am the good shepherd." In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, "I am the wisdom of God." In Song of Solomon, "I am the lover and the bridegroom." In Isaiah, "I am the suffering servant." Jesus would have said in Jeremiah, "I am the righteous branch." In Lamentations, "I am the weeping prophet." In Ezekiel, "I am the son of man." In Daniel, "I am the fourth man in the fiery furnace." In Hosea, "I am the ever faithful husband pursuing his unfaithful bride." In Joel, Jesus would have said, "I am the restorer of what the locusts have eaten." In Amos, "I am your burden bearer." In Obadiah, "I am the mighty savior." In Jonah, "I am the forgiving God." In Micah, "I am the messenger with beautiful feet." In Nahum, "I am the avenger of God's people." In Habakkuk, "I am the reason for your rejoicing." In Zephaniah, "I am the restorer of the remnant. In Haggai, "I am the desire of all nations." In Zechariah, "I am the pierced son." And in Malachi, "I am the son of righteousness." When we get to the New Testament, Jesus continues, because in Matthew, Jesus is the Messiah. In Mark, he is the miracle worker. In Luke, he is the Son of Man. And in John, he is the Son of God. In Acts, he is the ascended Lord. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1 and 2 Corinthians, he is the last and perfect Adam. In Galatians, he is the one who sets us free. In Ephesians, he is the head of the church. In Philippians, Jesus is our joy. In Colossians, he is the firstborn of all creation. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is the soon coming king. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is the mediator between God and man. In Titus, Jesus is our blessed hope. In Philemon, he is our redeemer. In Hebrews, he is our high priest. In James, he is our healer. In 1st and 2nd Peter, Jesus is our chief shepherd. In 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, Jesus is everlasting love. In Jude, God is our Savior. And in Revelation, Jesus is King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Jesus, as he was walking with these two disciples, points from Scripture, beginning with Moses and walking through the prophets and touching on every part of Scripture which they would have known. And he says, I am present from beginning to end. All of Scripture points to me. Jesus reveals who he is. Have not the prophets spoken about me? God's word from beginning to end reveals Jesus to us and shows us God's plan of salvation. Jesus, when he was speaking with the Pharisees and the teachers of the law and those who were questioning who he was, in John chapter 5, Jesus says, you diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. You diligently study the scriptures. And he says, if you believed Moses, and this was against the Pharisees and the scribes and the teachers of the law who held Moses in high regard, Jesus says, if you believed Moses, you would have believed me because he wrote about me. All of Scripture points to Jesus. Jesus is the common thread through the tapestry of Scripture and all of history. Let's continue on in Luke 24. As they approached the village to which they were going. Now, this is a 7-mile walk. When I was in Germany, we did about 7-8 miles a day, and it took hours. It says, as these two were walking, they were talking about these things. And then when Jesus came, they stood still, their faces were downcast, and Jesus starts to explain from Scripture. So this is a 2-3 hour journey for them as they're walking and they're listening to what Jesus is saying. And when you walk with someone and they're talking with you at the same time, you have a tendency to slow down a little bit. Because it's really hard to walk fast and talk too, at least for some people. But as they approached the village to where they were going, Jesus acted as if he was going to go a little bit further. And he's getting ready to leave these two behind, and it's getting late in the day. And the scripture says, but they urged him strongly, stay with us, come into our home, stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over. So Jesus went in to stay with them. And then Jesus, like he does on many times, in numerous occasions, he gathers around the table. There's a sense of intimacy and embrace. Verse 30, when he was at the table with them, he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it and began to give it to them. Whose home are they in? It's not Jesus's home. It's Cleopas and his companion. And yet Jesus becomes the host at this dinner. Jesus, the guest in the home, becomes the host. As he takes the bread, he gives thanks, and he breaks it, and he gives it to them. And then look at what takes place. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. Look at verse 32. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? There's this understanding. There's this recognition. And it's not just a facial recognition of someone that you know when you're out in town. One of the things that I learned on my trip to Germany was never stare or look at a German in the eye for too long and never smile when you do it. Because it creates a sense of, oh no, I know this person or I should know this person. And so many times they walk around with their heads down, not interacting with strangers, because if I might recognize you and you smile at me and look at me and I don't know who you are, that brings a sense of shame on me because I should know you. This recognition that we talk about here for Cleopas and his friend was not just a casual relationship or friendship where they recognize a facial image here, where they see who someone is that they recognize. No, there's this understanding within the soul that the eyes of their soul were open and they see Jesus for who he really is. Were not our hearts burning within us while we walked, while he talked with us on the road and opened scriptures to us? Friends, there's an intimacy around the table. What started off with dashed hopes and broken dreams and disappointments, we see that Jesus is revealed through Moses and the prophets and all of Scripture, and now we see an intimacy around the table. As soon as their eyes were opened, they saw Jesus as the Savior and Messiah, and then Jesus disappears. And they asked one another, were not our hearts burning within? Weren't we amazed at how he opened the Scriptures to us? Friends, the intimacy of the table cannot be missed. Jesus invites us to his table. It's a place of openness and welcome and embrace. It's a place of intimacy where we are known and we can know, personally know, and live in a relationship with Jesus, the Savior of the world. Look at verses 33 through 35. They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. Again, it's a 2 to 3 hour journey, 7 miles back by foot, back to Jerusalem, back to where the disciples are gathered. They run back, I imagine. They have to tell others about their experience and their encounter with Jesus. They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, it is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Friends, the relationship produces within us life transformation. When we come to know Jesus as resurrected Lord, our lives are transformed. And what the women at the tomb knew and what Peter had seen, they now too had experienced for themselves. They had experienced the risen Savior. Friends, Jesus is calling. He's calling you and he's calling me to follow him, to come and dine with him, to come and take your place at the table, at his table. It's a table where sin and guilt and shame are freely exchanged for forgiveness and freedom and a new identity. It's a table of warmth and embrace and welcome. And there's a seat at the table for you. Will you come? I don't have the following text on a slide or on the screen for you. And if you have your Bibles, just pick up and continue with me because there's some incredible things that take place. After the 11 gather and the Cleopas and his companion are there, something incredible takes place starting in verse 44. Jesus appears. And he said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Verse 45, listen carefully. "Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures." He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high." Did you catch what Jesus said? As Jesus appears before the 11, before Cleopas and his friend and all the women and others who had decided to follow Jesus, they had been left full of discouragement and despair. They were full of broken dreams. And then Jesus comes and reveals who he is. It says here that Jesus opened their eyes. He opened their minds so that they could understand who he was. And you know what else Jesus did in that upper room that day? Jesus ate with his disciples. one more meal, eating a piece of broiled fish to show that he was indeed risen. But he leaves them with this one thing. He leaves them with a mission, and it's a mission that Jesus has called all of us to. As the word comes and we prepare to close, I want us to focus in on this mission that Jesus has given us to do. He's called us to follow him. For those who have placed their faith and trust in Jesus, we are to follow Jesus in all things. And not just follow Jesus, but we're to take the good news of his resurrection and we're to proclaim it to those who do not yet know. Jesus says in Luke chapter 24, "You are witnesses of these things. You are witnesses of these things. Repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in my name to all nations, beginning here in Jerusalem." Friends, we're recipients of that good news. If you know Jesus, you are a recipient of that good news. You are the result of others before you, faithfully taking what they had learned about Jesus and sharing it with others. And for the last 2,000 years, followers of Jesus have boldly and courageously shared the good news of a risen Savior. We're here this morning to celebrate that Jesus is alive. He's not on the cross. The tomb is empty. He has risen from the dead. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. And our responsibility as followers of Jesus is to proclaim that good news to those who do not yet know. And maybe you're here this morning and you aren't quite sure who this Jesus is. Maybe you don't know who this Jesus is. And maybe just like that text, you'll need someone to unlock your mind. And Jesus did that. So he took the scripture, he opened their minds and showed everyone who he was. Friends, today's the day. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, all of scripture reveals who he is. And what better day to come know Jesus as Savior than on the day that we celebrate his resurrection from the dead. Let's stand together. Let's worship. And if you would like prayer this morning or would like to discuss that a little bit more with me, I would love to meet with you. The elders would love to meet with you. But let's stand and sing and proclaim. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for your death on the cross. We thank you that you did not stay in that tomb, but you rose victorious over death, defeating sin once and for all, defeating death once and for all, and allowing us to have the forgiveness of sins and to walk in intimacy with you. We thank you for the life transformation that you bring. We thank you that you've called us to follow you. We thank you that you have given us a mission to proclaim the good news to those who do not know you. And Lord, may we celebrate that Jesus is alive. And may we be faithful to what you've called us to do, all for the glory of our King Jesus, in whose wonderful name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Let's worship.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to lay mercy coming when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my fear rose to days. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over. Chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. She's darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with a freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes
Jesus, we thank you and we praise you. How good it has been this morning to come and gather and celebrate your victorious life. And Jesus, we long for and we greatly anticipate your soon return. And Lord, we ask that it would not be much longer. Oh, come, Lord Jesus, come. But until then, may we be faithful as your followers, Jesus. May we be faithful to take the good news of what you have done for us, of how you have paid the price for our sin, how you died on our behalf, and how you rose again. May we take that good news and your desire that all men and all women would come to know Jesus, you as Savior. May we be faithful in proclaiming until Jesus returns. We praise you and we thank you and we celebrate together because we celebrate in the risen name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Go in peace.